Okay, so this is going to be what I think is the second to the last video in our pattern matching series here. Today we're going to talk about what happens when you run into expressions that are so complicated that they can't fit into a single pattern. With things like fractions or scientific or products, things that will always fit into a single pattern. You won't ever run into an example where, a sum or a difference may throw everything off. Right. Here, let's say you're writing the equation of a line in slope-intercept form. Whether that second term is added or subtracted from the first term makes it a completely different pattern. So today we'll talk about how to bring all of that together and use them efficiently so that we don't have to build separate parsing mechanisms and separate matches for all of the different forms that you might run into. Today's going to be more of a build along. I'm going to work kind of fast. Feel free to pause as we go through. I won't be explaining a lot of the more basic CL sort of things here. So if you're confused with the CL, let me know on Facebook, on Twitter, here in the YouTube comments, and I can help you out. All right. So for this example, I'm going to talk about how to match and parse an equation or a linear equation written in slope-intercept form. I'm going to start off by making sure I make my life easy by using this p equals variable here so that I don't have to write patterns over and over again. And the first thing that I want to do is I want to think of the things I'm probably going to use a lot throughout this pattern. I know I'm using y equals something x, so I know I'm going to need x and y. So instead of writing p dot literal x and p dot literal y over and over again, I'm going to make variables for those as well. Now, I'm also going to make variables for things that could come in different forms. So a number could be a fraction or a number or a negative fraction or a mixed number. I also want to make sure that when I talk about a fraction, especially for my feedback here, I want to be able to say my fraction is in a particular form. Right, so I'm going to be kind of strict about the types of things that a student can type in this fraction. I'm going to be more permissive in the types of things they can type as far as what a number is. And then I'm defining x and y already in the beginning so that I don't have to type out this pattern over and over again. And what we end up with are four variables, x, y, number, and fraction, that I can use over and over again without having to write out the full pattern. Now, like any other pattern, I'm going to start by matching it to the pattern that I want to create. So I know that it's going to be something like y equals mx plus b. For pattern matching, we aren't allowed to match to an equation. So we're just going to take a look at this part here. The y is always just going to be there by itself. So I'm going to look at the m, the x, and the b here. And for this pattern, I see that we're going to call it the match pattern. Let's call it match. Right. This is the sum of two things. So I'll say it's a sum. And that sum is made up of the first term looks like it's a product. The second term looks like it's a number. So I'm going to say p dot product. And that product is made up of a slope, which in my case, just for today, I'm saying that I want it to be this particular fraction, where I define a fraction as an integer over an integer, where both of those, a positive integer over a positive integer. And then the second term in that product there is mx, so that's going to be my x pattern. So you can see I'm already starting to use that pattern over without having to type out the whole thing into a longer pattern. The second part of this sum is going to be that number. So regardless of how they write out this y-intercept, I want to be okay with it. All right, and you can see that I have a matching pattern here that's a sum of a product, which is mx, and a number, which is b. So let's take a look. Let's say is match, and I'll say when match dot matches. So when it matches the LaTeX, I'll just say yes, just like we did in our previous videos. Otherwise, I'll say no, and that'll just give us an indication that everything is going well. So I'll say, does it match? and I'll say whether or not it's a match. So if I type in something like 3 over 2x plus 5 matches, 5.1 matches. There are a few places here where this is going to break. Y equals. I haven't parsed the whole equation, so I don't know. I'm not able to match this full LaTeX string, which isn't just the sum of two things, to the pattern, right? So an equation currently breaking it. We're also looking at the sum of two things. So if I put a difference in there, also doesn't match. So we're gonna run into some problems. So I have two things for that. The first is something you've seen above here at this number pattern, even with the fraction pattern, and that's called any of. So what this does is it says, in order for us to match here, I'm just gonna take any of whatever I list out here. So it could be the sum of these two things, or it could also be a difference. And I can list out as many things as I want here, but for this one, simple enough, I only have a sum or a difference here. And now you can see, like, assuming I don't break the equation part of it, 3/4 x minus 10, now it matches because I'm taking either the sum or the difference. The second part, and this is actually more important than just this step, I can parse, or I can apply this pattern to any LaTeX string, right? I can attempt to apply it to any LaTeX string, which means that if I have some other CL skills, I know I can take an equation and I can split it into the left and the right hand side, so that even when they type in an equation, I'm only looking at that right side. So I'll actually call this the right hand side. And I'm going to say that if I take an equation and I parse it, and I use the LaTeX from the input. So if I take that input, parse it onto its left and its right hand side, and I just take the right hand side, that creates that RHS string there. And now instead of matching it to the whole LaTeX, I just want to match it to whatever's on the right hand side. So here, once I preview, I can type it all out. Y equals 3/4 x plus, ooh, that's not going to work, 3/4 x plus 5. And you can see it matches because it's only looking at the right hand side there. Now, once I've matched it, right, this is where the very first video starts to come back into play, where I said, you're going to make a pattern. You're going to match it, and then you're going to parse it, right? So everything up to this point, we could have just gone straight to parse. But here, this is where matching and parsing separately is very, very useful. Because the next step would be to look into these patterns and try to take out all of the different options. And the any of pattern won't let us do that because it's just used for matching. So we'd have to build separate patterns for fractions and negative fractions and sums and differences, all of these different patterns, trying to lump them into one is not going to be a good time. So using what we did before, where we matched first and then parse, we now know that the input matches what the pattern should look like. So we don't have to worry about the form very specifically anymore. I can just say, hey, I know that first term in that product is a fraction, so I'm just going to pull it out, no matter what it is. I'm just going to pull it out. I know that that number at the end, whether it's a difference or a sum, is valid. It matches, so I'm just going to pull it out. I'm not going to worry about what it looks like. And for that, I can actually then take two patterns, and I can, instead of being very specific, just say, hey, I'm going to pull the expression out. I want to parse the expression that goes with x. I want to parse the expression at the end of the sum. I want to parse the expression that goes with x in the minuend, and then the expression in the subtrahend here, right? So I'm going to pull everything out. I don't care what it looks like because I already know from the match that it's going to be of the form that I want. And that leads me to be able to make my slope and my y-intercept. A little bit more CL magic here. What I'm using is first defined value. Basically, I take the parse sum pattern, where I parse the sum out just using expressions. I take the first term, which is the product. I take the first term of that product, which is that expression that we've already determined to be a fraction. And I take the logtech from that. Same thing here. I'm going to take from the difference pattern, if that's the pattern that's defined. I'm going to take from the minuend. I'm going to take from that first term. And then I'm going to display it out. And then very similar in the intercept. The only difference with the y-intercept is that if I take that second term, that subtrahend, if it's like y equals 3/2 x minus 5, the thing I'm going to parse out is a 5. But because it's a difference, it's going to be a negative 5. So I need to account for that negative there if it is the difference pattern that matches. So two things that can come out, a slope and an intercept. And I can actually take that and let's take a look here. So you're going to get some things that maybe don't match super well. But let's take a look. This is not showing up real nice because, you know, it's not all error message. This is raw. This is not polished. And there you go. Right. So regardless of what it was, because I know it matches, I know that it's going to be a fraction. I know that this is going to be a nice number. I can change this to a negative and it still works. I can change this to a negative and it still works, all because I know it already matches. So matching it first makes it much easier for me to just take the parts I need without having to worry specifically every time I take something out that it matches something that I want. And now this is where being able to take any LaTeX string and use the pattern matching on it is useful. So we're able to take the equation, split it into the right-hand side and the left-hand side. The last step is now taking the strings that we just created and going even deeper and taking the parts that I want out of the slope. If I want the numerator and the denominator, I can now take it out of this slope because I know this slope is going to be a fraction. I know it's going to be a fraction because I matched it in the beginning. You know, there are ways to write this as one long pattern that you can match to and you can parse from. We actually work in a combination of the two. Sometimes we throw it all in one. Sometimes we do it this way. We're going to take it apart. But taking it apart and separating them by lines and making them as separate functions, separate variables, makes it a lot easier for you to tweak and edit as you go along. So I'd actually recommend, at least for now, unless you're really in tune with this and you're ready to just start writing, to kind of take each part step by step. Now, I want to take the numerator and the denominator from the slope. So I'm actually going to start like almost a whole different parsing from this here. This is going to go back to almost video 2. And I could actually embed video 2 in right here. And we're going to pull those two parts out. So I'm going to say like, I want to make a fraction pattern. I defined a fraction up at the top, but it used any of, so I want to be able to parse this. So I'll call this any fraction, where it's just an expression over an expression. Again, I know it matches because it matched all the way in the beginning. Now, I can pull the numerator out of that. And here, I just need to account for negative numbers in front of the fraction, right? So I do have any fraction where I can take the slope, right? Split it into its numerator and then pull out what it says. But if by chance that slope is negative, this pattern here accounts for that. So I'm going to take any fraction. I'm going to say that there's a negative sign in front of it. Still going to parse out from that LaTeX string I generated for my slope. But now I'm going to look at the thing that's negated, which is the fraction. So that kind of goes in one layer. So from negated, I'll go back in and look at the fraction. And then it's kind of the same here, numerator.latex. Take the numerator of that fraction. Same thing actually applies to the denominator. Right? I can take the fraction. Yep. Apply that pattern to the slope. Take the denominator of that slope. Or if it's a negative, first say I want to look at the thing that it's negating, which is the fraction, and then take the denominator of that. Now, once I've extracted my numerator and my denominator from my fraction, I'm just going to go ahead. I'm going to display it here so that we can see it. And now, on top of being able to use, you know, XY line, which, you know, we highly recommend using because it accepts things in all forms. If, for example, you're building an interaction where it's important to look at the y-intercept that a student enters, and compare it to maybe a rise and a run that's very specific to what the student enters, and you want it to be in a particular form. Pattern matching is great for that, right? We can take a general pattern, y equals mx plus b. We can say, you know, have it match these parameters. And once it matches these parameters, we can look really, really closely at the parts we want to look at. So for example, let's take a look at this screen here that I've just taken the fraction we worked on and the pattern we worked on and applied it here. So let's say a student enters y equals 3/4 x minus 7 over 2, right? If I use xy line here, I'm going to get 0.75 as the slope and negative 3.5 as the y-intercept. But here, I want to be able to take exactly what the student entered so that I can interpret it a little better, right? I can display their y-intercept as they wrote it, and I can build a slope triangle that uses their rise and their run, right? I could do, for those of you that maybe think that I'm just simplifying, if I do 6 over 4, it goes up 6, and over 4, doesn't simplify that down to 1.5. But if I do 3 over 2, I'll get the same line, but my slope triangle will go up 3 and over 2. All right, so we have different ways of looking into the equations that a student writes, so we can take out the parts that we want. And all of that comes from being flexible with the matching pattern. And then once we match that pattern and say, like, yes, everything in the thing that the student typed is good, allowing us to look into the parts just by like looking at the expressions, because we don't have to worry about patterns anymore. Now, this actually kind of breaks. I could break the rules here, and I could say, square root of 15, right? And I'm going to get nothing. Nothing's going to work because it breaks. It allowed me to enter an answer that didn't match the pattern, right? So just creating a match pattern alone isn't going to do it for you. There's also the question of, you know, how do I then know that an answer is correct or incorrect using these pattern matchings? We're actually going to save that for the last video. I know it's the thing you really, really want to do. You want to use patterns to say, write an equation in slope-intercept form and tell them if they're right and it's in the right form. So we're going to save that for the last video. It'll come out hopefully later this week, and we'll talk about using pattern matching to help you with determining right and wrong with your students. So until then, if you have questions, definitely send me a message at Mr. Chow Math on Twitter. Comment here in Facebook. Send me a message over Facebook. Send me an email, j@desmos.com, or post in the CL forum, and we can get your questions answered. But until then, I will see you, and good luck with your building.